First but lecture, may have the privilege to invite the chairpersons, Professor G. Prasad Rao, Vice President, come President-elect from IAGMH on the dais.
My revered, respected Guru, I have had my first learnings from none other than our President, Professor Rajiv Awasthi, who has been Guru for almost three decades. If I can see, he has been leading psychiatrists, and today he's going to talk to us on the healthy aging. Very briefly, I think introducing Ajit Awasthi to this gathering probably is like introducing son to each one of you. But nevertheless, he has been a loving person, a caring friend, a benevolent, guiding teacher who would indulge but also instill the discipline, and is known for his words, the way he communicates. He is probably something for the youngster sitting here to learn. And today, as we invite for the first invited lecture, it's my proud privilege and pleasure to invite Professor Ajit Awasthi onto the dais. Many sir.
The chairpersons, Professor G. Prasad Rao, Dr. Gautam Sahab. This is actually what I'm going to speak here is the outcome of the dialogue among the three of us. But particularly I'd like to mention the contribution of my very young colleague, Dr. Devakshi Dua, and she deserves kudos for making all the efforts in making this presentation possible. Before I start, I would like to share an anecdote with you. I often get invited to the center at Lucknow, which is the pioneer center in geriatric mental health. They run a number of courses, including the first DM in geriatric mental health. Often go there as examiner for DM exam. And I don't know what occurred to me that one of the candidates in one of the exams, I just blurted out, "Describe me what is normal aging." The fellow was at a loss. He could not answer anything. And I did a bit of reflection on my own self and found that even I was no better actually. Even also, I had some vague, nebulous ideas of what is normal aging. But when it comes to the real, you know, the task of defining normal aging or conceptualizing normal aging, I found myself quite at loss. And that propelled me to think about what is normal aging. And I think it's about time that I'm ready with some of the ideas which I can share with you. Find that how we progress from these various phases in life and reach somewhere here. Well, friends, when we talk about aging, it's a persistent decline. We are not talking of an interrupted decline. It is not that you decline and recover. No. It's a persistent decline, and which is because of the internal physiological degeneration. We are talking of a degenerative process, and that is what defines aging. It is age-dependent, and when we say age, that means the years that we put upon ourselves, and it is a age-progressive, so as many years you accumulate, there is a progression, and which is progression towards a decline in intrinsic physiological functions of the body, which leads to age-specific mortality rates. That means the chances of mortality increase as we age. And therefore, there's a decrease in the expected survival rate. When we are young, we don't think that there is a threat to our survival. But as we age, how many years are now left of my age? Because there is a decrease in the probability of the survival of a being. And that is, there is not only that, but also a decrease in age-specific reproductive rate. So we have decline and incapacity in discharging the reproductive functions which are central to the survival of our species. Every time there is a decline in functions, many things happen. I can give you some couple of examples. The net potassium loss takes place. So the flow of potassium from the intracellular to extracellular back, taking it back, that decreases, and that's very important for survival. Glutathione. The programmed things which are happening in our body, and that leads to the aging. Cellular apoptosis, there is a cellular death, and it is a programmed actually, the cellular program in which it sudden decay occurs as we progress. In fact, just 5 genes are responsible for 133 different kinds of cellular deaths which happen in the body. So this is all programmed in us. So I will not spend too much of time on that, but I will progress further to tell you, which leads to brain receptors. They become more and more sensitive. They make the psychoactive drugs very potent, the toxin, etc. The liver mass shrinks. There is a decrease in the hepatic blood flow and enzyme activity. We have metabolism, which drops to nearly half to even one-third or even to two-thirds of the rate of young adults. And enzymes, they lose their ability to process some drugs. And that contributes to the increase in the drug half-life. We have changes in our excretion rates, not only in kidneys, but also in the blood flow and water removal that becomes slow. We have age-related changes, which lengthens the half-life of renally excreted drugs. And then we have the changes in the distribution of the lean body mass. The adipose stress increases, stores, they increase. There is a total body water depletion, and it raises the concentration of water-soluble drugs, such as digoxin, as I told you earlier. And there is a plasma protein diminishes, and so on and so forth. Lot of changes happening in each and every, physiological organ of the body, and that leads to a slow decline and, some kind of a loss of functions. How can we define? We never thought of it, actually. We don't think of, how can I call myself that I've aged? Is it because of the chronology? Is it a biological change? Or maybe the chronology and the biology have no much role, but it is only an outcome of our sociological change around us. Well, if we go to the chronology, what do we find? It's defined as a passage of time from birth onwards. It's very easy to measure. You have just to count the years, and you can declare somebody old or not old. As many people now, the Indian Airlines regards me as old, whereas I'm not old by any definition. Right? People call me a senior citizen. I came to be called a senior citizen. I'm as sprightly, and probably even till date, my reproductive functions are intact. Right? And with the passage of time, there is an increasing incidence of physical, mental, and functional problems. And as I told you, age-specific mortality rates. So there is an arbitrary cutoff. We started with 50, then we went to 55. I don't know why, who decided it. Then Shaji, we came to 58, retirement age, then 60. I joined PGI, my retirement age was 60. In between, they increased to 62, then they increased to 65, And now I am on the verge of retirement. When I never wanted it, they increased it by 5 years. Now I want it and they don't want to increase, you know. What a tragedy of life. Now I want, they should increase my retirement age by another 10 years, you know, if not more, less. But if not more, but there's not. So develop, in the developed world, conventionally they have kept it at 65 years. What is the logic? Anybody can answer here, what is the logic? Why should it be 65? In Japan, on the contrary, 65 to 74 is preparing to be old age. It's not even regarded an old age. Preparing for old age, 65 to 74. So, actually there is a method in it. It's not as, you know, nonsensical as it appears to us. There is a method to it, and that is someone who has passed the median age of life expectancy. And life expectancy, it varies from place to place. And as you can see from this color chart, this is means the highest life expectancy, and this is the lowest. And now you can see how we are placed. We are placed somewhere, if you look at it, what is the color? 67.5 to 70, right? So you can look at it, the different regions, how they are progressing. Australia looks very green, Canada looks very green, all these countries, you know, Scandinavian others, they look very green. Hong Kong looks very green, but then that is how. So there is average life expectancy world over is 72 years. In India, it is 68.8 years. More for females than for males. So should we have different cutoffs for the retirement of females and males? Come on. Yeah, yeah, why not? Yeah, I know. You will go to the Supreme Court immediately. Okay. Or it could be sociological aging. That means if there are changes in persons' roles and relationships, you produce children, children get married, you become a grandfather or a grandmother, and you think you are old. Now I am a grandfather. Right? One can be a grandfather at the age of 45 also. What is the problem? You marry early, you produce children early, get them married early, and you have your grandfather or grandmother at a very young age. That doesn't make you old. So how do you define it? Within the network of relatives and friends, that is very important. That means in your network of relatives and friends, what kind of your roles and relationships are dynamically now changing? And that defines that you are supposed to be then wise, mature, which I refuse to be both, I refuse to be wise, I refuse to be mature, you know. Very assiduously I refuse. Or informal organizations such as workplace, and this is by and large influenced how the society perceives aging. Right? Some people can be as young as anybody. I remember I went to Istanbul with my wife and I saw a really, you know, much older man who was from Bulgaria, and he had such an attractive partner with him, and he was more romantic than what I was with my wife at the age of hardly 30 years, you know. So that is how it explains your mindset, you know. So there are roles, the relationships, the way you behave, and you are made to behave actually, you don't want to. But people make you behave, and that defines that you are now aged. But then there is another dimension, that is the biological. Now, it means there is a failure to maintain a state of homeostasis under conditions of physiological stress. Your tendency to, you know, there is a degenerative process going on. Osteoarthritis, more prone to infections, pneumonia, those kind of things. The resilience of the body to fight the onslaughts of both physical and mental and other disease pathogen stresses, both internal and external stresses, that resilience is gone and hence you age. So therefore it is increased vulnerability and it leads to a failure of adaptation. So there are many theories which are biological theories of aging. There could be cellular theories, that means you are a programmed cellular clock You can't do anything. It has a battery which is programmed to last for a particular period of use, and then the battery cocks off and the clock is used. So the battery is gone, clock is still there, but it doesn't tick. The soul is gone. So that charge is gone, that energy is gone from inside, whatever words you want to use it. Or there are the accumulation of waste products, and then there are cross linkages of DNA and connective tissue, which impairs the cellular function. There are physiological theories, because the supplies which are there in the body, those are irrepressibly lost, and hence you cannot replenish it. As I told you, that this client in total body potassium, and I gave you one example of the islands glutathione changes, which lead to the thickening of the avascular cell. But that is avascular cell, please remember it. Our lens is a avascular. Now, organ-based theories, there is decline in immunological competence, which grows with age. There is effects of calorie restriction, and we all know that people who do not consume more calories, they live longer. And your life expectancy goes higher. Or there is role of neuroendocrine degeneration, like your levels of the steroids and the growth hormones and the different sex hormones. Those go down. There are genetic theories. There is, I wish somebody reads about this, senohepatitis elegans. This is what I refer to, that five genes responsible for 133 cells being lost. So this is that thing. And there are pleiotropic changes, there are gene redundancy, there are modified genes, there are premature aging syndromes, and so on and so forth. So there is some genetic theories. And in Japan, when they were doing a lot of work, the genetic theories explained only 25% of aging. The 75% is not explained by genes. The 75% is explained by the kind of diet, nutrition, the stressors, and all those things, your mental attitudes, and so on and so forth, and the social relationships, and so on and so forth. Then there are unprogrammed genetic theories, like your exposures to pollutants, the damage due to the toxics, the radiation damage which happens to you, and errors in protein synthesis, and so on and so forth. I will not go into that. But all that I'm trying to tell you is, there are very sound biological theories which explain, or which are attempting to explain, the process of aging. So all organ systems are affected. There are varying rates of involvement. Brain is an area of focus. There are not only structural but also functional changes. And there are changes which can be assessed through neuroimaging as well as the neuropsychological assessments. And what do you see? That this structural changes begin by the age of 40 years. There is annual reduction of brain volume of 0.5%. Every year, you are losing your brain volume by 0.5%. On an average, after the age of 40 years, there are involvement of different regions. Their cortical involvement is much greater than the subcortical structures. This accelerates after the 70 years of age. And there are gender differences. Of course, women are more resilient than men any day. So there is shrinkage in cell volume, reduction in synapses, neuronal cell death, and there is a reduction in the gray matter of the brain. There is also the brain areas which are lost to develop are actually the first to be affected. Hence, the frontal and prefrontal regions of the body, of the brain, which are lost to develop, get affected the most. And that is the something which is there. There is a thinning of temporal lobes, but more consistent finding this is seen with MCI and dementia, that is minimal cognitive impairment. And then striatum, thalamus, nuclear accumbens are also consistently affected. But structural changes do not always correlate with functional impairments. So you may have structural changes, but despite that, your functional capacities may be intact. And there's a lot of variability from individual to individual in this regard. Now, these are the structural changes which I can tell you, the kind of structural changes which happen. So you can see from lateral ventricles all passing through right up to the fourth ventricle. Higher changes, least changes, which happen with age. This is a very interesting, we are looking at it. Then the cortical thickness per decade, which is estimated cross-sectionally, and you can see this, you know, from this. More the change, that means the area becomes lighter blue. Less the change, it remains still yellow. So you can see the changes in 1 year, what kind of changes, in 2 years, what kind of changes are happening in the brain. Now, again, the structural changes, again in the normal aging, and this is the Alzheimer's. This is again, you can see the different areas of brain. I will not bore you with all the, you know, details in this. All that I want to show you with this visual impact is that changes are happening with aging, and not only in the total brain, but more specifically in certain areas of brain that is happening. Now, there is significant heterogeneity in the rate of decline, and subcognitive abilities like vocabulary are resilient to aging. For some reason, I don't know. But vocabulary you don't lose with age. There is conceptual reasoning, memory, processing speed, they decline faster. Now, the neuropsychological test, MMSE, is the most commonly used. There are other tests which are there, but there is no single test which can actually be considered to be linked to outcomes in the aging processes. Fluid cognition, that means person's innate ability to process and learn new information, solving problems, attending to and manipulating one's environment, these are impaired very significantly, and it includes a lot of functions which can be assessed through the good neuropsychological tests available. Similarly, in memory, there are some area type of memories which get more consistently affected, and these have been seen. I think we can, it is associated reduction in dopamine level also, loss of gray matter volume, and even the impaired cellular vascular efficiency in aging. So what are the consequences? Normal age-related changes do not produce impairment in performance or daily activities. Decline nevertheless is present. There is poor processing speed, and mandatory age of retirement for specific professions is necessary because of aging. Like, contrary to the myth, doctors that keep on practicing till they want to, you know, they should retire at a particular age, because otherwise the medical error rate increases, patient satisfaction rate decreases. Right, so therefore, professionals like doctors must retire at a certain age because they are losing some of their critical capacities in the brain. At the same time, one must consider a diagnosis of MCI dementia if the impairment becomes too gross. Now, sociological changes, the changes in social roles, social relationships. Traditionally, elderly are looked up to, this is what we used to say, it has become more of a cliche now. Now everybody looks down, you know, the elderly, and I'm going to have that fate, you know, in some years to come, and I'm prepared for it because I will climb even on the higher stories of my building to look down on others, you know, if I can't do anything else, you know. So I won't take it. The source of experience, insight and wisdom, again cliches, and increase in dependence on others. This is the reality. They become dependent on others for their physical, financial and emotional support. You must have seen most elderly people, they start crying, you know. My children are taking great care of me, and they start crying. Yes, that kind of, they become very emotional, you know. So please try resisting those kind of changes in you. Ah, this is the ideal picture. Wish I could achieve these different states. I want to get arrested here only. You don't want to progress further. What's the fun of going to the stage? No, I don't know. Who are these jolly sitting there? So, that's it. But what you find is, the Western society is youth-centric. Eastern society, elderly are held in high esteem. If you are making any change in those values, please stop it. Fourth way, value your elderly. That's all I will say. Resist those changes. Don't watch TV. Don't read Supreme Court judgments. Don't read newspapers. Be very happy that I don't want to get influenced by all these, you know, stray thoughts. Elderly ancestors are not given special importance. Your ancestors need to want them. Fear ageist stereotypes and aging considered to be a part of life process is inevitable. It contributes to growth and wisdom. We should, you know, value all these things. So, we role as a caregiver, loss of loved ones, loss of social status. Your role as a caregiver is very tenuous then. Your loss of livelihood, you need more social support, you have increased health needs. Go to any elderly. And if it doesn't stop there, and that's why you see those kind children and so many. Even Deepika Padukone is also now, you know, advertising for something against the constipation. I don't know why. Such a beautiful girl, you know. Source of stress during aging process. So frequent changes and transitions and all these things, you all know it. I will not repeat it. And there are nevertheless one thing which we must note, there are variations in aging process. And these are differences both at the biological level and the sociological level. We don't go through the same sociological influences and conditions around us. Some of us are better off than others. And our financial capacities and all those things, our physical health capacities also differ. Therefore, it is important to make use of biological age rather than chronological age. And we must assess these individually. So that we don't just as one uniform policy throw people into the quadrum of the aging phenomenon. At the same time, there are a lot of changes which can happen, and structural variations are also there, and this is a known fact now. Some people develop the cardiovascular changes, endocrine changes more than others. So let's hope that we have a healthy life so that we can arrest or delay the process of aging. What is the management implications of knowing all this? The management implication is that prevention is better than cure. Once you are old, you are old. You cannot become younger. So try to prevent becoming old, mentally, physically, and in whatever way you want to think about it. Treatment of specific symptoms. Limited success is there anyhow. But nevertheless, one must keep on looking for it. Research currently is focused on retarding the process of aging. Very ambitious. Why do you want to retard the process of aging? You just try, research on that. But at the same time, look at things which are more easily done to prevent or delay the process of aging. And these are varying all over. So recent trends are, there are pharmacological, anti-wrinkling, creams and all those kind of things. The drugs which can do genetic modulations and, they can increase your lean body mass and those kind of things. Genetic lifestyle, so there are targeted now, research on not allowing the telomeres, length to shorten. Now, because that is being linked with the process of aging. And then I think antioxidants, hormones, and so many things. But I think the real game is here. Your lifestyle in terms of your nutrition and the amount of exercise that you do. And if you don't do exercise, at least deliver one lecture a day, because that itself will give you a lot of exercise. You will have to bend, you will have to stretch, you will have to speak, you will have to walk under. So to do that at least. So defined as low probability of disease and disease-related disability, high cognitive functional capacity, active engagement with life. Don't stop it. And not merely the absence of impairment associated with age-related changes. There is a continued growth and well-being, which is the essential component of this. And see what happens here. This is where I want you to focus. Continue engagement with life, maintain physical cognitive functions, That means physical and mental activity. Minimize your risks for disease and disability. So, don't allow yourself to succumb to various infections. And even if you have degenerative changes, do compensatory mechanisms to counter those, you know. This is all. You will have to maintain and enhance your social connections, mingle, move, and manage. These are the three M's which will ensure that you stay young. So move a lot, mingle a lot, and learn to manage a lot the challenges which you will inevitably face. So the main components are avoiding and minimizing diseases, maximizing physical and mental faculties, active social engagement, overall well-being and quality of life must be improved, and you must lead a life of independence that will ensure you, my friends, a very healthy longevity. And various models are followed, and we can look at some of those, and those are the physical activity, lifestyle modifications. You have the example of the Mediterranean diet, restricting your calorie intake. Alpahar, dheerghaayu ke liye zaruri hai. Ye to ayurvedic diet hai. But then, look at that conferences, what we are doing, you know, overeating ourselves. Cognitive stimulation, social engagement, alternative therapies, one must take one amla in the morning. It will make you feel good. Take some murabba. For whatever value it has, but think it is good and it will prove good for you. And that will lead to, you know, the positive psychological traits develop in you, and keep romancing and flirting, that will be very good for you. So there should be holistic approach, overall independence, improved quality of life, policy implications must be there to promote health of elderly, interventions must begin early to have an impact in state life. That means when we say promote health of elderly, give them assurance in terms of their financial capacities or independence, make some programs for them. In Japan, as you know, now it is incumbent upon the many of the young children, they go and spend some time or even weekends with elderly when they are feeling very lonely. So what is the status in India? Here, 60 years of age. I am 64. You find me elderly? No. Alka, you don't find me elderly. Thank you. So, this is 60 years of age. How many of us, we have all crossed? Even my friend sitting there doesn't find himself elderly. Dr. Tiwari. Although he's younger.
My mother.
Oh, she's a very young lady. She's a young lady sitting by the side of an old lady.
No.
Okay. And constituted 8.6% total population in 2011. More than 40% of elderly still continue to work. That is something which we ignore. More than 40% of elderly continue to work in India. They are not receiving any social security. They are continuing to work for their own survival or for their short term abilities and contribute to household income. I am continuing to work and contributing to household income. Isn't so? Yeah. And they have increased longevity and physical and mental illness and associated disability is also increasing, unfortunately. We have to bring it down. So there is a changing social milieu. Globalization and Western influences have to be fought with all our mind. We don't have to promote nuclear families, but we should go back to our joint family systems, which are very good. Actually, and dependence on other for social and emotional needs must be encouraged. We must have the ability to cry whenever we want to, and not only cry, but cry keeping your head on the shoulder of somebody whom you like. And then neglect and abuse has to be addressed so that we have strict penalties if we neglect or abuse our elderly. There are cognitive behavioral impairment, often considered a part of normalcy process. There is the acceptance of diversity, there is lower incidence of dementia, Shaji will bear me out, in India. There is research, however, is limited and focus is on disease and still not on wellness. So I think this is a responsibility of IIGMH to shift its focus. Therefore, what we need, good diabetes control program, good hypertension control program, poor primary health care services are there, they have to be improved. so that they are there available nearer to the places where elderly work and live, and hence they can access. And we have to avoid this unhealthy aging. This will in turn help us to minimize the incidence of the dementia as much as we can do. Proportion of elderly population is rising. By 2050, from near 9% will go to about 20%, it is expected. Disease-related burden will also rise. So it is not just on a very lighter tone that I am talking here. It's a serious concern, a public health concern. And hence, all of us have to engage ourselves very seriously as health professionals to combat this problem. I conclude, normal aging is a diverse process. Some of you are luckier than others. So think you are on the luckier side rather than the unluckier side. Work towards pushing yourself towards the luckier side. It involves structural function changes. Focus on successful aging is essential. And recent advances are focusing on retarding the process of aging with inconsistent results rather than focusing on a successful aging. I would say there should be a paradigm shift in research from retarded aging or retarding the process of aging to enhancing the process of successful aging. That will probably serve a very large number of people, and therefore towards the end, I would say engage with life, empower the seniors, optimize mental physical functioning, promote health and prevent disease. You must have, you know, intellectual stimulation, financial security, physical well-being, emotional well-being, and a great social life, and some, like, you know, a spice, a bit of spiritual enrichment of your life, and that will then make me say, happy aging. Thank you very much.
For retirement has been in consonance with the improving life expectancy in this country. And the cutoff age of 60 years was kept following recommendations of a commission which Government of India constituted, known as Iyer Commission. The third point, that aging has genetic endowment, but it is not genetically programmed at any stage. That gives a strong clinical message that you can modify the process of aging by so many environmental manipulations, your diet, exercise, because it is not genetically programmed. Third point which I wanted to, at cellular level, the biological changes which lead to aging. Some people say use of hormone replacement therapy, particularly the ladies, and the patient in some kind of hormone. Hormone replacement therapy can work, otherwise there's no point. Same story goes with antioxidants. If you are deficient in some kind of vitamins and all that, then go for antioxidants. It should not be a fashion taking antioxidants. Thank you.
Thank you.
Considering that you're looking so young and handsome, 64 years. There's another different classification they have given regarding the aging, what is called as young old and old old. You know, 65 to 75 years are treated as young old, in the sense they can be as young and as energetic as anybody else for that matter. Lucky that you come under that category.
I am young, not young old. Yeah, nothing like young old. I am young.
Just to add a little bit of fun, of course, that physical includes sexual also.
The young lady has arrived. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Professor Indira Sharma.
Moment to our speaker, Professor Ajit Awasthi.
Thank you, sir. Now request
to kindly felicitate our chairpersons, Dr. G. Prasad Rao, Dr. Gautam Sir. Now, let me have the privilege to invite again Professor Ajit Awasthi, President IAGMH, Dr. O.P. Singh, Honorable Secretary IAGMH, to kindly chair the sessions.
Professor Head Department of Psychiatry, Neel Ratan Sarkar, Medical College, Kolkata, and he did his MD from LHMC. We all know he has been the General Secretary of the, he is the General Secretary of the IAGMH also, and has done a stellar, you know, played a stellar role in performing the functions of his office. You know. But it's indeed a great honor for us to invite Professor S.C. Tiwari. And he is the founding president, not only founding president, he is the founder of the Indian Association of Geriatric Mental Health, his brainchild, his baby. And he galvanized the movement of geriatric psychiatry in India.
Thank you, chairpersons. And thank you, organizers, for having given me this opportunity to talk mind of others and then ultimately, finally, my mind about needs of community-based, models of community-based geriatric mental health services, which one is the best for India. In the beginning of this talk, I have brought greetings from you, for you, from Lucknow, the ancient monuments, the Mahabara, great alma mater, the King George's Medical University, and also from Department of Geriatric Mental Health, which came into being 2005. And in 2018, the Land of Development in Lucknow, that now we have a mental health foundation, Lucknow, Uttar Pradesh, India, which is going to work on a pattern of networking, arranging benevolent mental health services to masses of the state and masses of the Lucknow. You will be hearing, and you must have been hearing about this, about growth in population of the elderly, which is because of improving health services and increasing life expectancy, which was in 1951, 32 to 45, 32.5, 45 years for males, and it was less for females, 31.66 years. Now in the year 2016, because of improvement in health services and our awareness about our health, the life expectancy for males has increased from 32.45 years to 67.3 years. And for females, which was less in 1951, it has increased even over men to 69.6 years. The rate of elderly population growth in the country in 1951, it was 5.3%. In 2001, it was 7.4%. In 2016, it is 8.4%. And the projected growth in population is 12.54% by year 2026. This all is leading to in abnormal growth in mental health, say in geriatric population, the magnitude of the mentally ill in growing population at this point in time is 22.6 million in the country, which is on a modest calculation of 20.5% prevalence, which has been found in an ICMR study carried out in 2010 and 13. You can imagine how many people are looking towards us for any kind of mental health care help and services. The health care, before we talk of a model, let's try to understand what are the requirements, what are the needs of elderly population which are mentally sick, and how those requirements, needs can be integrated into a model to provide best community model for the care of the mentally sick. These are the health care needs. If you look at the treatment gap in mental health problems, it is 90 to 95%. In physical health, the treatment gap is not that much, but specialized treatment is not available to many of our elderly who have different kind of problems. They are difficult to diagnose, to manage, and rehabilitate. That has given rise to concept of the duplicity, that their problems are always confusing in nature, dubious, and it's difficult to diagnose. They suffer with multi-city, the concept of five cities, that they have multiple physical and mental health problems at any given point in time. And then most of their problems are chronic, giving rise to the issue of chronicity. Polycity, most of the elderly suffer from polypharmacy. They go to one physician, to one doctor, to the other doctor, and everybody goes on adding medication, even without looking at the previous prescription what the person is taking. And then complexity. Complexity of the diagnosis, complexity of the management, and complexity of the treatment. Our elderly suffer into these five cities that gives rise to this concept because of so many issues involved with management of elderly population. Besides healthcare needs, elderly have lots of psychosocial needs, which Professor Ajit Awasthi just now narrated before you. And for an elderly, if these needs are not met, only they are able to provide them healthcare needs, that will not be enough in a model which should be called as best model. Then the financial needs, and moreover, the residential needs of the elderly population is too much in this country. The dependency ratio is increasing day by day in the country, and many of the elderly are not working. They suffer with financial constraints. They are not allowed by their children to spend money on their recreation, on their worship, on their this kind of say works, and many times the children do a financial abuse of the elderly people. Many elderly are thrown out of the houses, and they live either in some kind of temples or in mosques, or find some place to settle down. And that's an important need of the elderly population. There are legal needs. Many patients, they have legal needs to fulfill. The state mental health authorities have a coordination with district legal authorities, but hardly they find ever any kind of free advice and they have to run from pillar to post for their legal needs. How we can best address these needs? The presently available models are hospital-based models, like mental hospitals, geriatric psychiatry nursing homes, departments of medical colleges, private hospitals, private clinics, NGO-operated centers like ISKCON in Chennai. The presently available community models, community-based models are home-based, old age homes, both government, private and NGO operated, halfway homes, self-help groups, religious places. But these, they suffer because of a number of problems and elderly are not able to use them because of the cost, difficult to access. They are centralized in cities and provide services only in a centralized manner. Meets only some of the health care needs, not most of their psychosocial needs. There's a high patient-doctor ratio. Few psychiatrists are available for a large population of the older adults. Maintains the stigma associated with mental illnesses. Cases of human rights violation are very rampant with these elderly people and lack of meaningful activities for them to participate in any kind of activity. Appearance of deficit symptoms because of such kind of situations which our elderly face, and those who are kept in such kind of nursing homes, they suffer with the syndrome of institutionalization. The timely healthcare needs, in spite of they being kept in, due to the behavior of the healthcare providers in these hospitals and nursing homes, are quite often careless and not congenial for our elderly patients, subjects to live there. The community mental health or community-based community psychiatry is defined as all branches of medical sciences, defined as detection, prevention, treatment, rehabilitation of emotional and behavioral problems as they appear in the community, rather than as encountered on one-to-one basis in large psychiatric facilities or private practices. That means if something has to be community-based, it should be able to meet the emotional and behavioral problems besides healthcare problems of the elderly whenever it arises. In other words, it means treating the community inside the community itself for emotional, behavioral and physical health problems, whatever arise. The community mental health management treatment model aims at providing cheap, effective, specialized psychiatric care in the community. A perfect model, community mental health model, should be able to address the following needs: the residential needs, psychosocial needs, healthcare needs, financial needs, legal needs, safety and security needs of the elderly. Only then it can be called to be a perfect model. Further, they should be close to home or mobile, including services that provide home treatment, address rehabilitation as well as treatment, adhere to international convention on human rights, reflect the priorities of the service users themselves, and are coordinated amongst mental health care providers and agencies. For a model, a good model, these things should be there. The available models in Western world is, one is in Canada, system of integrated care for older persons in community through interdisciplinary team. There's a team from a hospital or wherever it is based, that visits the committee to treat the ailing elderly population. Then there's a model of University of Minnesota model, care in community through one each geriatrician, nurse and pharmacist for maximum of 25 patients. Many more models in Western countries are available, but they all integrate available medical facilities for managing these people in the community. They depend upon outside resources. The Western models are usually integrated to hospitals. The needs of the elderly are met through these models, not the majority of psychosocial needs. Available infrastructure, trained manpower, and adequate finances in Western countries help them in taking care of elderly. But that may not be a possibility in near future in our country. The available community models, which I just talked about, are home-based, old age homes, halfway homes, shelter groups, religious places. None of these models are complete in themselves. There is lacking of these models. They are utilized because a good model does not exist. Dependent upon outside resources, which is usually not available to these people. A study was done. Dr. Vikram Patel from India was also part of that study in Nigeria, Philippines, and India. And three models of community-based mental health services were provided. One was exclusive community-based, the second was clinic-based with some activities in community, and third was integrating community and hospital. Hospital are equally, integrating community and hospital care equally, that they call as balanced care model. Now let us look on each model. The exclusive community-based model involves utilizing services of community health workers for active case finding. That's a very positive aspect of this model. They visit house to house, old age homes, halfway homes, religious places to identify mentally sick persons. Utilize services of village heads, priests, faith healers, etc. for information on mentally sick persons in the community. Provide services such as treatment of common mental disorders and public awareness regarding mental health problems. That's another positive point of this model. Also utilizes services of self-help groups in the community. This has some similarity with our district mental health model, which is part of national mental health program in the country. Mental health centers in both government and private sectors. In addition, the old age home should have inbuilt facilities for addressing psychosocial needs of the elderly. An interdisciplinary model, medical and mental health team should periodically supervise healthcare needs, and similar interdisciplinary team consisting of human rights activists, personnel from departments of social welfare, district legal aid authorities should supervise the psychosocial needs of the elderly. With all these facilities are existing in the country, we need to simply integrate them to provide a perfect model and which is accessible, approachable for our elderly population in the country. I have summarized that model, which can be called as contemporary old age home-based community geriatric mental health care model. This integrates all available services plus old age homes in every district for the time being established by state governments through Government of India aid, and this does not require much of outsourced resources. You need to utilize available healthcare services and services of community-based old age homes, which are being established with so many issues, psychosocial issues of the elderly people to be addressed to into that community. And I think by all means if we can channelize our community-based geriatric care model, that will be the best and will not require that much of resources as other models, whether it is Western model or the model, the three say models which have been proposed by a group of workers for at least our country, India. The carry home message is till such a time that one integrated old age home is not available at a population of 60,000 between two primary health centers. Integrate services to meet all kinds of needs of the elderly mentally sick to upcoming one old age homes in every district. Advocacy for mental health policy, which we are now trying to develop it. Infrastructure, manpower, resources to meet the needs of the growing population.
As on the healthy lifestyle issues, although you have mentioned about psychosocial issues, but I think healthy lifestyle issues are very, very important, and these are important throughout the span or lifespan of the person and become more important in the elderly. For example, let us look at exercise. Yesterday there was in the newspaper, the study says very clearly that the exercise is very little, less than the desired in both men and women, but much less in women. So we need to look at this. This is very, very important. And lot of space, and most people do not have place to do exercise and games. So a lot of things are underutilized. Say schools are running for 4 hours, the playgrounds are empty. Why can't the government ask these schools to let them out to their elderly? So I mean, these type of things should be there. There should be facilities for exercise in the neighborhood. There should be facilities for recreation, for socialization. And then there must be also involvement of the elderly in the community. What I think your presentation was more concentrating on the very sick and abandoned elderly. But there's also a good group of elderly who are not really abandoned and who actually have a lot of money. Say they are having a lot of pension, but they don't do any work. And this is what I call is a nothing to do syndrome. So these people can be a great asset. Both for themselves, they will improve, their cognition will improve, and they can be utilized in various activities, say for teaching people, social work and so on. I think these things are very important. Social isolation is another issue. So I think diet is very important. And I find that now when we are getting patients in the at least 4 to 5 lifestyle diseases every patient has. So these are so important. And diet is a very major issue. And I find that good diet, food is not available anywhere, almost nowhere. You go to a restaurant, all oil, all non-veg. And although the WHO very clearly says that vegetarian food is preferable not for ethical or religious reasons, but for health reasons, we find that the quality of food is very bad everywhere. And it is very important that at a national level, a policy should be made that healthy food should be provided in restaurants and hotels and so on, and marriages and so on. Because after all, where do you eat the food in all these places? And that is where they have dyslipidemia and obesity and whatnot. So I think these issues also need a lot of attention. And we can suggest some methods to the government. It is for the government to accept them and implement them.
Thank you, my friend. What is available, what is not available, making available through Government of India old age homes. It's wonderful.
Thank you, sir.
If you see the activities of the old age homes, it's so good. But are we ready to do that?
Thank you,
sir. It was wonderful diversity to kindly honor our respected speaker, Dr. S. Tiwari.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I hand over my mic to Dr. Anita for the next session.
We now take the privilege to make an announcement that just after the lunch, in this hall, Imperial Hall number 1, we'll start with the Sweta Tiwari Award session. And for this session, respected Dr. S. Indira Sharma and Dr. T.S.S. Rao will be the chairpersons for Srimati Sweta Tiwari Award session. And this session, post-lunch, just after the lunch, which will be followed by IATMS INTAS Award session. And this IATMS INTAS Award session was previously scheduled to be held in Dynastic Hall. This program has been shifted to Imperial Hall, Hall number 1, just after this Sweta Tiwari Award session. And in Dynastic Hall, just after the lunch, the symposiums number 2 and 4 will take place as per schedule. So now, taking forward the program, we have come to the last program just before the lunch. So may I now, now we are having Siv Gautam Oration Award in Geriatric Mental Health, and Professor K.S. Sazi will be giving the deliberation on multimorbidity and depression in late life. And for this session, may I take the privilege to call upon our respected chairpersons, Dr. S. C. Tiwari and Dr. S. P. Gupta on dais. Sir, please.
Give this oration in front of a very focused audience. In the next few minutes, I will try to impress upon you how a condition like depression has very serious public health implications when it happens in late life. Aging is happening along with lots of social and economic changes in this country and countries like ours. Though dementia is often talked as a big problem, if you look at the prevalence, there is nothing like depression, which is widely prevalent even in the community settings, probably less recognized. And as this presentation progresses, you will recognize the implications of being depressed or having clinically significant depressive symptoms in late life. This is the biggest problem. It happens along with, in late life, it happens along with, as Professor Indira Sharma was referring to, you have morbidities and then depression. Or you have morbidities, then you go on to develop depression. You have depression, then you develop other morbidities. So, it is usually associated with significant functional impairment. Huge treatment gap exists in the management of depression across life cycle in primary care, much more so among people who are older and having multimorbidity. Many a person with multimorbidity, with diabetes or hypertension, usually seek help in primary care settings. Unfortunately, the depression may not get recognized or treated properly. High rates of depressive symptoms, but the ECS study classically said that syndromal depression is less, which has to be seriously looked at again. The criteria have changed. We have found syndromal depression, if you go by minor and moderate syndromes of depression in the community, it's quite prevalent. This is based on data which was collected by assessment by clinicians trained in psychiatry. Of course, this has to be implicated. The most important point is that it is heterogeneous. Depressive symptoms are widely prevalent. There are syndromes which would meet criteria for mild depressive episode, moderate and severe. But then coming down in the line on moderate and mild depressive disorders, the heterogeneity may be much more common. Usually associated with slowing of information processing, most of them, than normal. And as we could easily recognize that if I have disability, I might become depressed because of that. Or depression in late life may have inherent reasons to disable you otherwise. An interesting finding is about subsyndromal depression. Now there is clear evidence which says that if you have subsyndromal depression for a long time, then you are at risk to develop a major depressive episode. So incident depression, especially a major depression, is much more high if you have persistent depressive symptoms. Two issues which we might want to discuss in detail today is about the issue of frailty and issue of multimorbidity. Let us take multimorbidity first. It refers to a situation where you have two or more long-term disorders. Vast majority of people over the age of 65 will have multimorbidity. The issues, special issues raised because of multimorbidity is exemplified by if you have dementia and say diabetes. Then you have multimorbidity and then the whole management issue will change. It will depend on the kind of disorder which you have. One very sad thing is that if you have multimorbidity, the outcome is going to be poor. And unfortunately in this country, not only in this country, in most countries, if you have multimorbidity, the way in which the health services would respond to your needs is very bad. They are not used to this. In fact, I will argue why, and we must take efforts to change the scenario here and elsewhere. It's not about older people. Multimorbidity is not only about older people. If you count the actual number of people who have multimorbidity and seeking help in a primary care setting, younger people will outnumber. About 50% or slightly more than 50% would be people below 65, but almost 50% or less than 50% would be people above 65. Interesting observation is that if you happen to be from a socially deprived community, then you are likely to have multimorbidity having its onset 10 to 15 years earlier in your life. That's quite bad. And if you have one of the multimorbidities that happens to be a mental health problem, then you are likely to have multimorbidity earlier. I think all this discussion today, we have been listening to normal aging. One of the things which is important about multimorbidity, see, everybody has been referring to the advances we have made in medicine. But look at any clinical practice guideline. It talks about as if that clinical guideline is meant for treatment of a person with that disorder and that disorder alone. Most clinical guidelines talk about how to treat a person, say for example, diabetes, who is aged between 18 and 65 years, with no other disorder, not even hypertension. This is very unfortunate. It is not only in clinical practice, it's also in the training, it's also in research. Another sad observation is that when you count or classify someone as having multimorbidity or someone has a self-reported multimorbidity or a diagnosed multimorbidity, if you look at those people carefully, there are still undiagnosed problems. And invariably, they get a bad deal. This is something which we must earnestly address and try and change. One article says that what we have achieved in the last century is that we are quite good in technologically delivering technologically driven treatments to depressed. Their frailty and depression could be seen as, now I'm just postulating, there is a possibility that among such people, frailty and depression could cluster. And you know, then addressing those issues will also require addressing issues like social isolation. When you are socially isolated, your brain is not stimulated. When your brain is not stimulated, you become more inactive. When you become more inactive, so there are issues like that. We cannot wish away complexity. Complexity is the reality. Multimorbidity is associated with inappropriate prescription. Neurologist doing prescribing something, cardiologist you prescribing something. And we need clinical practice guidelines to accept that when you have diabetes, you have more than one disorder, usually. So then it takes a life course approach and that has to be addressed. One problem with universal healthcare is that there is just last few slides. There is this inverse care law. If you are needing more services, you end up getting poor services or less services across the world. Demanding general practices serve very poorly. So when the needed, much needed areas, unfortunately, tend to get very poor services. And there is this positive care law, which says, this was actually postulated after looking at the kind of informal care which was being provided when it was needed. It clearly says that, article says that when market forces are operational, the inverse care law will prevail. When market forces are not operational, then caregivers will give free time and then provide positive care. But then, this should be our approach.
Answer and comments are permitted in the oration. So, thank you all, and the session is closed.
Now, may I request our respected chairperson, Dr. S. C. Tiwari, to kindly felicitate our speaker, Professor. So, kindly felicitate Professor K. S. Sazi.
Loneliness and social connectedness with depression in elderly, which is a multi-centric study under the aegis of Indian AGMH. The session will be chaired by Ma'am Dr. Indira Sharma. Ma'am is a professor and HOD of Department of Psychiatry, Heritage Institute of Medical Sciences, Varanasi. Ma'am has done her MBBS in MD Psychiatry and PhD in Forensic Medicine. She is also the chairperson of Patients' Rights Indian Psychiatric Society and editor of the Journal of Child and Adolescent Mental Health. And she is also the editor of Indian Journal of Behavioral Sciences. Ma'am has more than 125 publications, both international and international levels. Our next chairperson will be Dr. T.S.S. Rao. Sir is the secretary of Human Sexuality Section of the World Psychiatric Association. Sir has done his MD Psychiatry from CMC Vellore. He is currently serving as Professor of Psychiatry, JSS MC Mysore. Sir is also the longest serving editor of Indian Journal of Psychiatry. Now I call upon Sir Sandeep Grover, sir, for the presentation.
The prestigious award of Indian Association for Geriatric Mental Health is institution in memory of Mrs. Shweta Tiwari, wife of Dr. S. C. Siva Tiwari. This time I have only one paper and Dr. Sandeep will be presenting. Please, Sandeep.
Thank you, Chairperson. I'll be presenting the paper on relationship of depression in elderly with loneliness and social connectedness. This paper arises out of the multicentric study which was done under the aegis of IAGMH last year, and this is one of the papers among the series of papers which are coming out of this study. And at the outset, I would like to thank all my co-authors who have contributed in various ways in getting this paper into shape, right from the beginning of collection of data till the publication of the paper. What we need to understand, basically let's try to focus on loneliness. How is it understood? Loneliness is basically understood as a discrepancy between desire and the real social relationship. And in the Western countries, the data suggests that the loneliness is prevalent across all age groups. However, it is much more common among elderly, with prevalence rate varying from 11% to about 43%. And due to this, elderly are said to be more prone to develop loneliness in the Western countries. And however, what has been understood that aging alone is not responsible for loneliness, and various psychosocial factors, including the demographic factors, do contribute to the development of loneliness, which include like gender, marital status, level of education, either person is employed, not employed, is financially stable or not, and they play an important role in development of loneliness. We can understand the importance of loneliness from the Western world is giving it to that. In UK now they have a formal ministry for loneliness. So we can understand what is the importance of the concept of loneliness in the Western world. And the data suggests, various researchers who have carried out various studies, that it has been very clearly shown that loneliness is associated with so-called premature deaths, and also increased morbidity in the form of chronic physical illnesses and cardiovascular diseases, which are actually considered to be a so-called forerunner of development of dementia and various cognitive decline. And besides the dementia, what has been shown that loneliness also affects mental health of elderly, in that it increases the tendency to have negative thinking, decreases their self-confidence, decreases confidence of others or significant others, so that whenever although they are saying people, they still don't trust other people, and they are always scared of being abused or secluded in the society, and this possibly leads to development of depression. So the Western data suggests that loneliness is basically a hidden killer of the elderly and strongly related to development of suicidal ideation and parasocial behavior. However, looking at the relationship of loneliness with depression, what is not yet established is what is the cause and effect relationship between the two conditions. However, what is being understood that as the severity of depression increases, loneliness increases, and loneliness also predicts the intensification of depressive symptoms, also acts as a predictor of lack of remission in depression. So patient who develops depression may not improve because of the loneliness. However, when you look at the data, the findings are inconsistent as per the understanding of the relationship of loneliness and depression is concerned, and the concept of loneliness has been understood differently for different cultures, and that's why definitions have varied, so we don't have a clear-cut answer to that. And when you look at the data from India, there is very limited data from India. There are only very few small sample size studies occurring, have done in the one or two centers. Keeping this in mind, the aim of this study was to evaluate the prevalence of loneliness among elderly patients with depression, to evaluate the relationship of loneliness with social connectedness and severity of depression among the elderly, and to evaluate the demographic and the clinical predictors of loneliness and social connectedness. As I have already alluded to, that this was a multicentric study which was done under the aegis of IAGMH, and it was approved by the local institutional ethics committee, and we had 8 centers participating in the study. 3 were from North India, like Chandigarh, Srinagar and Jodhpur, 2 from the East India, both in Calcutta, and 2 centers from West, one in Mumbai and one in Ahmedabad, and 1 central part of the India, that is from Lucknow. And these centers For the inclusion of the patient in the study, basically what we need to understand, the patient were required to be aged more than 60 years of either gender, has been diagnosed with depression, which is confirmed by mini blood, and patient with comorbid intellectual disability, dementia, or who were very sick to participate in the interview, where no informed consent was obtained from them, and they were evaluated on five important scales, that is Geriatric Depression Rating Scale, GAD-7, that is General Anxiety Disorder Questionnaire, PHQ, that is for somatic symptoms, and Columbia's Suicide Severity Rating Scale. Besides that, they were rating on two scales, that is the loneliness scale, which is 20-item scale, and the social connected scale, that is another 20-item scale. So in this paper, we are basically focusing on understanding the relationship of loneliness and social connectedness with depression. The data was analyzed in terms of frequency and percentages for the categorical variable. Mean and standard deviation were deduced for the continuous variable, and comparisons were done by using key test, chi-square test, and variability test, and correlations were done by using Pearson and the Spearman-Plank correlation. And the significant findings were considered as values less than 0.05 in the two-tier test. So this is the basically the patient distribution across the.
Thank you, Dr. Brower. This has been a nice paper on a very important issue, that is depression, social connectedness, and loneliness, and which we witness to a very great extent. Well, I would like to make a comment and also put a question to Professor Brower. One is that the three things that you have studied, it is depression, social connectedness, and loneliness, they are interlinked with one another. So how you tease them out? This is one thing which I am not able to understand. And secondly, we have talked about depression with melancholia, melancholic depression, and depression, non-melancholic depression, or depression with atypical features. So because it is a type of depression which actually determines whether a patient would like to be lonely or would like to be connected with the outside world. And whereas melancholic depression would like to prefer to be alone. So I find that this has not been addressed, this issue. So I would just like your expert comments on this.
Understand the cause-effect relationship and how these three variables are interlinked or not. Our aim in the study was to evaluate whether these three variables are actually related to each other in the Indian context or not, so that we can plan further study where actually we recruit the sample from the society or the community, where we evaluate the patient for all the three variables, so that we have patients with and without loneliness, with or without depression, and with or without social connectedness. Then we evaluate how these three variables are linked. So this study does not address the cause and effect relationship between these three variables. I am very clear about that, and I have no qualms in admitting that. Regarding the melancholic and atypical features, this study again did not evaluate those features. That was basically, this was a concept kind of a study, that we let first evaluate whether this happens or not, and can how much is the overlap. So at present, I can say that tomorrow when we do a study in the community, we can understand possibly that actually these concepts also have some amount of overlap. That person who have loneliness are more likely to have depression, those who are lonely may not have depression at all. That also can emerge. So that is where this concept has been evaluated, we need to take it further from here. This study does not answer the question which you have in mind.
Before I conclude, there was one, of course, when you are talking about this concept related to loneliness, you might have seen even in our IGP, we had at least about two major papers on loneliness and currently the changes that are happening, socially speaking, in different countries. We used to read about something called anaclitic depression in children.
Yeah.
Whether the same concept, analogous what we see in case of irritability, whether correlation and difference.
Yes, people have evaluated that and people have found an association between that. So that's where basic thing what we need to understand, that let's start as a psychiatrist looking at the concept of loneliness. I think that's where we should move further from it. Because it's related to depression in all the issues. In fact, right from childhood, in fact, people talk about depression right from infancy also, that maybe as we are talking about neglecting, mother being neglecting their child, or children not interacting. All this has to be understood from that perspective. At least first, first we need to understand that whether there is less of awareness among psychiatrists, they don't understand loneliness as a symptom per se. They do not recognize that as a symptom or a so-called characteristic which we need to evaluate. So at least in this study we can evaluate, we could evaluate and we could find that it is highly prevalent among patients with depression. That's the only thing which I can say at this point.
Wonderful presentation. And one clarification is how do you define the loneliness in the areas like some patients are, you know, having so many family members and he has been neglected and he finds himself lonely.
Yeah.
And other group of patients who are not actually having no family members, most of the time he is found lonely. So which type of loneliness or what are considered in your this type of study, the loneliness? So if the loneliness is more of a neglected type, he is having more of a depression or anxiety, is there any that type of finding in your study?
As far as understanding loneliness is concerned, let's understand it very simply. What you desire and what you like. If, for example, many people are sitting here, if I try to ask them, and if you see many people very much busy on their own, and they still don't feel themselves lonely, they feel they are connected with people, but they may be lonely. So what we need to understand, what you desire, whether you are getting that or not, that is the concept of loneliness. Now, regarding that, whether somebody is being neglected or somebody is actually alone, does this study evaluate that? We have not gone to evaluate those features in this study at this point.
In the classical review of suicide and loneliness, it is said that it is the loneliness, not the hopelessness, which initiate the suicidal gestures. So how do you have a sense here, what is your impression regarding, is it the depression which is called the suicidality or it is the loneliness itself has some relation with the suicide behavior?
Sir, that part requires a separate kind of analysis.
Because you have not the suicide scales here, that's why I am asking.
That's what I am just trying to explain you, that we have not gone into analyzing that kind of data at this moment for this paper. That basically requires taking suicidal outcome or suicidal behavior as an outcome variable and using both depression, social connectedness and loneliness as the independent variable, how much do they predict suicidality, that needs to be evaluated. This study, at this moment, the data which I have presented, we have not gone into that part of the analysis.
Regarding the substance abuse, you know, tobacco is the maximally used.
Yeah.
Whether it is due to the easy availability or cultural setup was there.
What we need to understand that tobacco use was present out of the 500 in about 100 patients, 20%. If you look at the prevalence figures in psychiatric patients as far as substance use and tobacco use is concerned, these figures are almost comparable. So this is availability across the country. We are not looking at one or two centers. And the prevalence of tobacco use is similar across all the centers. So I would say that this is the prevalence figures of substance use in this study possibly reflects the substance abuse figures which we have any other age group in patients with mental illness. So we cannot say that availability is the only issue because these people are elderly. They may be using tobacco in the form of smoking for quite long time. So availability should not be only considered as a factor which is responsible for the tobacco use in these patients.
Thank you very much.
Professor Suresh Chakrabarty.
program, which is the IAGMH or INTAS Award. This award will be chaired by Ma'am Dr. Alka Subramaniam. Ma'am is the Associate Professor of TNMH and BYL Nair Sage Hospital, Mumbai. Recipient of the Marfatia. Ma'am has more than 50 original publications. Along with ma'am, there will be Dr. Hiramani sir. Sir is the professor in Department of Psychiatry, RIMS Imphal. Sir has done his MD Psychiatry from CIP Ranchi, has worked as HOD of Department of Psychiatry, RIMS from Imphal from 2006 to 2017, and is the president Indian Psychiatric Society, Manipur State Branch. Sir, I humbly request you to kindly chair the session along with ma'am Alka Subramaniam.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for those of you who have sustained the afternoon and remained in the hall. The awards are usually the heart of any organization, and we strive every year to improve the competition. And we encourage the young ones sitting behind to send your papers after attending this conference this year. The IAGMH INTAS Award is unique because it is a pre-decided set of winners. There are marks given only for theory, and the presenters come here and present the work which has already won the award. So they were given their awards in the inauguration ceremony, and now they have 15 minutes each to present your work. That's 12 minutes plus 3 minutes for questions.
I call upon Dr. Rashmi Satpute, who is the first prize winner of the INTAS Award, to thank the winner. The paper is entitled "The Role of Optical Coherence Tomography in Assessing Early Changes in Cognition and Networking."
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm presenting my research paper titled "Study of Role of Optical Coherence Tomography in Assessing Early Changes in Cognition in Elderly." So we know that population aging is the most significant emerging phenomenon, but dementia is not a natural part of aging. It's an end-stage state. The symptoms of dementia include cognitive deficits in multiple cognitive domains, which cause social and occupational impairment in patients. Of all the causes of dementia, we all know that Alzheimer's disease is the most common cause of dementia with its increasing incidence. It not only has an impact on personal, familial and societal level, but also induces strain on caregiver. Now, considering the slow progression of the illness, the process of neurodegeneration is likely to start quite long before the clinical manifestations are set in. So this transition phase is known as mild cognitive impairment. Typically, we have seen that 10 to 15% of people with MCI progress to dementia per year. This implies an importance of early diagnosis of dementia, which can lead to early intervention and slow the progression of illness. Now, what are the biological, what are the biomarkers that are available for us to for early detection of dementia is biochemical and imaging. So, of that, we have studied optical coherence tomography as a biological marker. Now, what is the connection between optical coherence tomography and dementia? We all know that retina is an extension of brain, that is, it has developed from neural tube, that means examination in neurodegenerative diseases. So what is an OCT? It is an optical imaging technique that has emerged to the forefront with its high speed, high resolution and capability to analyze the retina and optic nerve in vivo. So in this process, initially we dilate the pupil of the pupil and then examine retina. Similarly, which is shown in the figure, that the patient sits in front of a machine which takes around 5 minutes and during which the retinal images are taken. So we basically measure the retinal nerve fiber layer, which is composed of retinal ganglion cell axons, which forms the optic nerve. So decreased thickness of RNFL is suggestive of axonal loss in optic nerve. So as per the study by Benjamin Kim et al., they have identified that mean RNFL thickness is reduced in MCI, which is even more reduced in dementia patients. There is also a recent study by Roberto Santangelo et al., who has also concluded OCT as a biomarker for progression of worsening of cognition. There are no Indian studies on optical coherence tomography in dementia. Thus, the discovery of new non-invasive and cost-effective in vivo biological marker is the major aim in the current research on dementia. So, research question is, is OCT a biomarker for early detection of cognitive impairment? So the aim and objectives of study were to record the socio-demographical data of MCI patients, dementia patients and healthy controls, to perform mini mental status examination, add-in group cognitive examination, clinical dementia rating scale on healthy controls, MCI patients and dementia patients. Also to measure the peripapillary RNA fill of both eyes by OCT and to compare between the parameters on three groups. So it was a cross-sectional study which was performed at Nayan Hospital with a sample size of 75, meaning 25 patients in each group. But as we had to exclude 5 patients of dementia, so we included 20 dementia patients, 23 MCI and 17 healthy, meaning totally 60 patients. So approval by Institutional Review Board and Ethics Committee was taken and written informed consent of the participants with the help of participant information sheet was taken. The inclusion criteria for participants were aged more than or equal to 60 years, who are educated up to 8th standard and above, and who are willing, the patients and relative who are willing and able to participate in the study. For the dementia and MCI patients, we diagnosed them as per DSM-5 criteria. So the instruments were like, we initiated with recording the social demographic details with the help of a semi-structured performer. Then we measuring the intraocular pressure, meaning the glaucoma was one of the exclusion criteria for which we screened the patients for intraocular pressure. So the patients who had high intraocular pressure were excluded from the study, in which we had two dementia patients who had high IOP and were advised other investigations. The participants who had normal IOP underwent optical coherence tomography, during which we had three patients who were not cooperative for the procedure and therefore they were excluded. Thus, this after the exclusion of total 5 dementia patients, we had healthy controls which were 17 number, 23 of MCI and 20 of dementia, on which we performed cognitive assessment in the form of MMSE, ACE3 and CDR scale. Now, these are the 5 domains under which of ACE under which the population was assessed. ACE is reported to have good sensitivity and specificity for identifying dementia with a Cronbach alpha coefficient of 0.8. MMSE is a 30-point questionnaire, as we all know, measured for screening of cognitive impairment. CDRS is a scale which is for staging the severity of dementia. It is a 5-point scale which with CDR 0 indicates no cognitive impairment. So the procedure we followed, that we had approached patients of dementia, MCI and filling the inclusion exclusion criteria and who were willing to give written informed consent, after which we recorded the socio-demographic data, MMSE, ACE3, CDRS and performed OCT on the patients. So in results and discussion, the mean age of our population was 65.7 years with minimum of 60 and maximum of 78 years. The majority of population in our study was males, which was 68.3% and 31.7% were females. In our study, we also found that 83.3% of population had no medical comorbidity, 5% had diabetes, 6.7% had hypertension, and 5% had both diabetes and hypertension. This is a distribution of study population as per the DSM-5 criteria into dementia, MCI, and no cognitive impairment, where we found 33.3% had severe cognitive impairment, 38.3% had mild cognitive impairment, and 28.3% had no cognitive impairment. This is a table showing comparison between the peripapillary RNA fill with the MMSE score between the three groups, which was significant, meaning that higher the MMSE score, higher is the RNA fill. This is a correlation of CDR scale with peripapillary RNA fill, which is significant at 0.01 level, where we found the negative correlation, meaning that higher the CDR score, that is higher the severity of dementia, lower is the RNA fill. This is the ACE3 domain-wise correlation with the peripapillary RNA fill of both eyes, where the correlation was significant with the domains of attention, memory and language, meaning that
my topic is psychiatric morbidity in elderly with cancer. So, coming to the first slide, cancer in the elderly population has become an increasingly common problem. 60-70% in 65 years or older suffer from cancer. And thus, we should consider these needs making decisions about their care and treatment. Cancer is not only a series of very different diseases needing complex and multidisciplinary treatments, but also a very stressful event with significant psychosocial impairments and implications related to the physical, emotional, spiritual, and end-of-life care. And these aspects are generally timed with regards to the past, the present, and the future. Space, for example, one's own individual space, one's own home, and one's own world. Context, existence, example, confrontation with mortality. phases of cancer presenting risk for the onset of psychological distress. From the moment a suspicious symptom is found, maybe a lump, maybe immature ear, to being informed about the diagnosis that yes, sir, yes, madam, you are suffering from cervical cancer, you are suffering from carcinoma of breast, awaiting treatment. What treatment should I take? Should I take chemotherapy? Should I take complications? Should my treatment end here? Chemotherapy, how many sessions? Radiotherapy, how many radiations I should take? What is a lot of things come to the mind. Then discharge from hospital, how will I survive at home? Will I survive? Failure of treatment, I had a round of chemotherapy, no response, my tumor has increased. Recurrence, I had improved. 1 year down the line, I have again had another recurrence. I mean, altered sexuality, loss of certainty, you become unstable, feeling of loneliness and abandonment. You have need to depend on others, now you can't work. You have a changed perspective about your future. You might be thinking that at the age of 65 I'm going to do this, at the age of 75 I'm going to do this. Now you are facing the reality that you might not survive for more than a year or two. Threat of possible death, you might die maybe within the next 15 days. So these are the various things which actually hit your heart when you suffer from cancer. Threat to the social and interpersonal dimensions from cancer, both a sense of belonging and a sense of communication, both are shattered in a cancer patient. And the psychological aspect also depends on basically cancer at the physical level and the effect of cancer and cancer treatment on body image. It's a very important aspect. Visible cancers, example breast cancer.
Now the prospect to study on NCHF. Certainly on the background of the study, why you have to do this study. This is the United Nations 2015 report, which says the life expectancy of 60 years has increased gradually from 1950 to 2015, from around 4 years to 18 years, and the broader lens indicates that by 2015 it's going to become 20 or 22 years. And there is small rise after 80 years also, but not much increase. So this means that this is good actually, in a way that the life expectancy of 60 years is increasing due to advances in medical fields. But this is positive side. The negative side is that it also comes a lot of non-communicable diseases which one has to face. And this another figure is from the same United Nations from 2015, which says the proportion of people increasing from 1950 to 2015 from 4%, from 5% to almost like 9% now. And it's going to become around 18%, 20% by 2050. That's the recent report in absolute terms, if you talk, we have 20 million people in 1950, people above 50 years. In 2050, it's going to be 300 million. It's almost like a moderate amount of country's population of elderly people. Not only this, we don't know about this, people are above 80 years, who are very less studied, and we don't know about what exactly the medical comorbidities or about their mental illness. And this proportion also slowly rising. And about the MCI, mild cognitive impairment, today's topic. MCI is the transition phase between normalcy and dementia. If a person can stay there, can worsen, or can revert to back normal. So this concept came in the recent, it's a relatively new term actually. It came in the 90s and then it became more popular, and thousands of articles published on this topic. And recently, after the revision of dementia criteria by NIA and AIA, but also they also revised the MCI criteria, included biomarkers to define it for research work, not for clinical work, frankly. And to identify people at risk for dementia so that we can keep a follow-up of them and see what happens to them. And also, as treatments, as all the monoclonal antibodies or vaccines, all treatments are disappointing in terms of in treatment of dementia and prevention and cure. So we are moving towards pre-dementia phase, like one is MCI, which is more properly defined and measured.
And this is the patient, you know, look at the other parameters, whether it's sexual needs are equal, whether it's sleep is okay. Because whenever we hear sex, we think of something else. So trial and follow-up. Cancer care professionals must offer trials to suitable referrals for suffering patients according to their psychosocial needs. These include mental health, social work and counseling, cognitive chaplaincy services. Follow-up with the more distressed patients who require regular and timely assessment, whether we can refer them to various things, and if we actually feel that they need our treatment, we have to treat. Standard guidelines, there are a lot of standard guidelines from the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, the Canadian National Standards. The American College of Surgeons, the Association of Oncology Social Work, and in the oncology, we have nursing care, we have psychiatric care, we have nowadays guidelines have come up, and we can, their well-being, return to work, and possibly serve. The choice of intervention is related to several variables, including the clinical psychological condition, the type and phase of illness, and the context of the illness, availability of psycho-oncology services with trained professionals. We have psychosocial intervention, including counseling, education, psychotherapy, meditation, guided imagery, any number of things are there with us. It's just that to the patient reaches psycho-oncological.
Hyponatremia with the use of antidepressants is old age, female gender, past history of hyponatremia, low body weight, low baseline sodium levels, summer season, initial phase of antidepressant use, and early onset psychiatric illness, longer duration of psychiatric disorder and prolonged admission, concomitant use of drugs like diuretics, NSAIDs, chemotherapy, ACE inhibitors, reduced renal function in the patient in whom we are using antidepressants, and presence of medical comorbidities including diabetes mellitus and hypertension. But the data in Indian context is usually limited in the form of case reports and case series only. So there is need for the study is because there is lack of any systematic study evaluating the association of hyponatremia with the use of antidepressants, especially in elderly population in Indian settings. Aim of the study was to evaluate the demographic and clinical risk factors for development of hyponatremia among elderly patients started on antidepressant medicines. It was a retrospective study, was approved by ethics committee, and exclusion criteria was if there is history of recent gastroenteritis, recent change in any medication for concomitant physical illness, and patients having bipolar depression or any other indication or OCD or schizoaffective disorders in whom antidepressants could be used, or in some cases of schizophrenia and with depressive symptoms or with OC symptoms in which antidepressants can be used sometimes. The inclusion criteria was patient taking antidepressant due to any depressive or anxiety disorder, age more than 60 years at the time of prescription, for whom sodium levels were available just prior to starting of antidepressant medicines. So treatment records of elderly patients were reviewed. We divided into two groups. Patients were divided into two groups, hyponatremia including 35 and non-hyponatremia groups containing 43. And socio-demographic, clinical profile, and risk factor associated with hyponatremia was reviewed. The definition of hyponatremia that we took in this study was serum sodium levels less than 135 milliequivalent per liter. And the antidepressant-associated hyponatremia was labeled when the same was confirmed by at least two consecutive reports. This is the socio-demography of the patients. And in this table, it can be seen that both the groups, hyponatremia as well as non-hyponatremia, it is basically a retrospective chart review. We saw the patients who had hyponatremia. We reviewed the status that which antidepressant was started and what was the and over a period of time what happened to those patients. So with that only we divided 35 patients into hyponatremia group that we were able to find. And there were numerous patients who didn't develop hyponatremia, so we took it random.
So the control group was random selection from the people who didn't have hyponatremia.
Yes.
Because the proportion of people who were on mirtazapine were high in hyponatremia, which is not in matching with the published studies available. Prevalence is much more with SSRIs. Is it possible that people who had previous hyponatremia were started on mirtazapine as a preferential clinical practice to avoid kind of precipitating hyponatremia?
We took that factor also into consideration, that whether previous history of hyponatremia is there. But all the patients that we reviewed, there was no previous history of hyponatremia.
And in mirtazapine, what was the duration of gap between starting mirtazapine and then developing it?
This was one of the limitation of the study, that we didn't took into account the time period of starting of
hyponatremia. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Sir, I would like to call upon Dr. T.S. Rao, sir, to kindly felicitate the chairperson.
Thank you.
Sir is presently the professor and head of department of psychiatry, NGIMS, Sevagram, Maharashtra. He is trained in child and adolescent mental health in HIMANS. Dr. Mishra sir has more than 30 publications and more than 50 presentations. He is a reviewer and editorial board member of several national and international journals.
Thank you, what a nice interview. If somebody is thinking that I am in terrible pain and there is no way I am going to go through this, that's high risk. And patients stockpiling pills, I have had elderly people who, you know, family would keep the morphine and she is supposed to take it every 4 hours. She had taken 20 pills together and came to the hospital in an opiate sort of overdose. So in the intervention, you have to tell the family to the supervised medications and not to keep the medicines. This is particularly true for elderly patients with cancer. And you know, for patients like everyone will be better off without any. So again, these are things which you should be very cautious of. So medical predictors of risk, you know, feeling hopeless. Recent discharge, there's a recent paper that, and it had mostly men, in fact 100% men, a paper from the US, which talked about the recent discharge from the hospital. Again, the risk is higher. When it comes to cognitions in elderly cancer patients, you know, it's around 50% of the time, sometimes like 2-3 figures. Brain is safe, but that's not true anymore. So it does, you know, cross the blood-brain barrier. And all these factors, you know, like surgical stress, anesthetic exposure, delirium, post-surgery delirium, these all affect cognition. If your brain is being radiated, sometimes certain cancers need, you know, whole body radiations. And there is, you know, we shouldn't forget that these are patient-spent protocol, but we use that mainly for young patients with brain tumors. But we do get patients who have finished treatment for breast cancer at 65 or 67 and say that I cannot remember very well. So we use Western memory scale for that to quantify that. And these are things like, you know, exercise, you know, mindfulness. These things sometimes help in the behavioral aspect. Cognitive rehabilitation, short subcortical stuff, sometimes increases cognitive, and of course environmental things like list calendars, etc., makes the life better. There is one RCT on methylphenidate showing that it improves fatigue and cognitive outcomes. Very few RCTs. It's a difficult patient population to do a randomized controlled trial. There is some evidence on modafinil. Mixed results, some trials show good effects, some trials don't. These are the time points where, you know, my previous speaker had mentioned that, you know, these are the time points which are particularly stressful. You do remember pain, disability, sensory loss, increased age, you know, these are factors which are...
She did work very hard, but... yes?
She's technically retarded.
She's technically retarded, or she's... technically not exposed, yes, and retarded is a stigmatist term.
Reluctant to change.
Not ready to adopt the technology.
Why would she not be ready to adopt technology?
Maybe from fear or...
She was in a happy environment.
Sorry?
She was in a happy environment.
There's no need. Okay, so one is motivation then. Anything else? How many of you have grandparents whom you have tried to teach technology to? What happens? Yes, what happens?
She doesn't keep remembering whatever it is. So
memory, yes. And what else? What else seems to be a thing with them which is difficult? Are they as quick as you?
No.
Even I'm not as quick as yours. So you see that the dexterity and the speed is something which is genuinely an issue. Right, so essentially we need to interview them in depth to provide data for what we call as HCI research or human computer interface research focusing on the elderly. I have very few landmark studies that I can actually share with you, but I have tried to bring that data here. Unfortunately, most of it is not Indian data. So this is the largest study done in the US where most seniors report, if you see the 65 plus, usually and only a little help is needed to use any technological device, particularly a smartphone.
And when they talked about their confidence level, most of them had very less confidence while using a smartphone, right? So olders have, elder individuals have problems like visual and hearing sensitivity. When they listen to videos, you know, they put it on really loud. They don't realize. It's not that they necessarily need a hearing aid, but it's just the hearing sensitivity has gone down a notch as compared to the rest of us. Finger dexterity is not so much. They're not as fast. Working memory is also affected. And to top it all, the screen interface is a smaller interface as compared to what they want, right? And that becomes more complex when they are dealing with the mobile phone as compared to the younger individuals. Besides that, the number of apps, having a busy screen and multiple menus drop down, tends to take a lot of practice, which requires training, and therefore they find it difficult and sometimes just shun it away. So when we look at all the obstacles, things which are important for us is focus.
There are also people who are using smartphones and related things. This is a very classic observation what actually has been noticed. So when you understand that this is actually creating problems, it is actually creating difficulties in getting used to this particular system and all of that. This is one of the reasons why grandchildren, if they are present in the house, they live much longer when we talk about it. It is actually related to, in fact, they are the best teachers and can help them.
Sure.
Many of the times, these daughters, sons and all of that, they feel teaching these old people is a difficult job. They don't learn and any other such things. But the young fellows,
yes,
actually, they are extremely useful and this is one of the things, socially, what actually has been.
Absolutely. The idea of presenting this as a series of things was to show that this is actually the pattern of use. Initially, there's a lot of rejection from the elder individuals, and subsequently, they adopt it and adopt it well with training and education, you know, which is usually from the youngsters in the house. In fact, there's evidence for that.
In the beginning, I was a little anxious because Mrs. Rao was there.
I put the disclaimer.
Right at the outset, I would obviously congratulate the speaker before me for having set the stage and the standard so high. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee of Geron 2018 as well as the CMB committee of Geron for having given me the opportunity to come here and speak. I'm not very familiar with the topic in the sense in terms of day-to-day usage or having patients whom I use mobile phone apps to assess their issues or problems. As far as most of my clinical assessments and experience is concerned, it is the good old mental status examination and the usual pen and paper methods. However, it was definitely an interesting journey going through what has taken place in this world of technology, what have come about in this world of apps, smartphones, and to what extent it has actually flooded the market, more so in the West, but gradually trickling to the low and middle income countries also. So first, I would just like to, topic is basically assessment, technology-based mental health assessment in the elderly people. So I have a very neutral Mr. X, so no one need to worry anything. So this is basically Mr. X, he's a 65-year-old man and he visits physician for a regular health checkup. Before meeting the doctor, he's given a tab basically, where he is asked to fill up a form addressing few basic background information. While he fills up the form, an app runs in the background collecting data about the time he takes to complete the form and compares it to normative values of his age and gender, getting a rough estimate of his cognitive performance. The app also takes note of any important words mentioning family history of mental illness, stress factors, etc. After completion of this form, the nurse escorts him to the examination room to check his vitals. Thereafter, he is asked to complete another small questionnaire asking about his daily biological functions, sleep, appetite, etc. and also mood states, how he feels for most parts of the day, say for the last 7 to 10 days. Finally, he is asked to play a short video game which assesses his concentration and other cognitive functions. It is basically a small cognitive test but occurs in the form of a game which makes it more attractive. He doesn't feel that he's actually undergoing a test assessment. The doctor assesses Mr. X and finds he has mild depressive features. After the entire gamut of this assessment as well as the direct face-to-face interviews done, he advises him exercise.
Depending upon the varieties of cancer, the magnitude or intensity of depression is quite different. So could you a little bit elaborate in the area?
They found that the intensity of depression and depending on the type, percentage of depression is almost, the prevalence is similar. If you look at the intensity, it is more in cases of breast carcinoma, carcinoma prostate, small cell carcinoma lung, that variant has been found to be having more cognitive symptoms. Colorectal cancer. These three cancers, if you look at the depth of depression or the intensity of depression, is much more. And for small cell carcinoma of lung, the cognitive symptoms are much more. This is what the meta-analysis I found.
What I wanted to know is what could be the reason?
Yeah, reason. Number one, if you look at women breast cancer, the physical appearance is a very, very important aspect. Breast for a female is a important component of her individuality, that she is able to give something to the child. So that association is an important aspect. Once somebody loses the breast, there is a mastectomy. Exact mechanism I don't know, 2 or 3 things I could read on that. So going in depth into all the cancers is a very, very huge thing. Small cell carcinoma, for the cognitive symptoms, they found out the metastasis are there, the effect of medications.
It's rapidity of metastasis.
No, if there are any brain metastasis. Carcinoma lung many times present as tube mass in the brain, secondaries in the brain. So that might be causing a lot of cognitive impact.
Being a woman or being a man, the masculinity of family, breast is supposed to be one of the major characters. So once that goes, that is somewhere shattered inside. Second thing, as we discussed about the facial cancers,
a person, the more the chronicity increases, the chances of depression, we all know, increase. So there are few things which add to it.
Anyone in particular, all three can take the question as I can take and discuss. I say there is only 2 issues. Number one, in the whole deliberation, we find that when the question of euthanasia comes, we comprehend how to deal with it. And our purpose is to tell the patients that you should not do this. Indirectly means that euthanasia concept should go off. Is it just because it has not been legalized in our country? And if we consider it, this group is coming in cancer, we are going to get 3 types of cases. One, the cancerous patient whose case have been detected much late and they have been given a very bad prognosis, that at the age of 70 you know that you are going to be part of it. Another, it will have been less intense, less prevalent cancer, and then lead to this relatively longer period of time than other cancers. We have to distinctly from it. Our goal is that the patients, you told me your chart patients is at 80 plus, or say 70 plus, whoever patient is there, in this age of deterioration and children going away, who is there? Who we call family, when you call our family, so the other family member may not be cancerous, but he will be equally crippled by other diseases. think of a lady of 75 years suffering from any cancer, and I have seen being brought to the hospital by a frail, what was telling today, in that one, a very frail old man who had hardly carries it. And this is the scenario. And in this background, the three groups of persons are distinctly different scheduled conditions. We cannot make them one.
Regarding euthanasia, suppose talk about my personal opinion. For us, it is not an option.
We have to discuss beyond legality. Because tomorrow, suppose our country is going to legalize, some of us could be the opposite, other factor also.
Passive euthanasia, we are following in terms of not gradually lowering down the support level, maybe not introducing certain things which are required. Somebody is in chronic pain, you know it's not going to exist. You put him under sedation, huge amounts of sedation, the patient gradually cutting down on maybe not admitting or do coming or the ventilator support. Passive euthanasia is being followed in India.
That's not the point. The point sir is making is, as a civilized academic forum, unless we debate it, we won't explore the cultural specific values. So my personal views, for want of time, I won't be able to show them now. I have seen patients who have very clearly articulated, and I have video recorded them with consent, and I did not feel that she is depressed, and she had considered the idea of euthanasia. That was what we talked about over several sessions. So I think your point is absolutely taken. I don't think if today gay marriage, gay relationships are accepted, 50 years ago people might not have debated that. So I think ethics has, law always doesn't catch up with ethics. That law doesn't necessarily follow, it should follow society, but society also has to guide it. Now, if you see the way the inverse pyramid, the way population is exploding across the world, I think this will be an issue at some point of the time. There's a beautiful novel where, death seizes, death by intervals, and the chaos happens in the world. So I think your point is very well taken, sir. I think we should debate. We should ask at least the stakeholders, what do people think about it? Doctors, elderly people, young people, lawyers, and not necessarily inform the law, but we should debate. Yeah.
I would like to call upon the both chairpersons, Dr. Shanmugha Singh and Dr. Sumar Shukla, to felicitate our first speaker, Dr. Amrit Patel.
Sir, come on.
Professional photographer.
Can be aggregated, they have done, they have classified or they have made groups according to the age of onset, that is early onset, intermediate onset and late onset. But the cutoff age is there is lack of consensus, and the recent studies they have used a cutoff of 50 years for ages of onset, that is early onset is before 50 years and late onset is after 50 years, and this has been, and now the studies which are there, they are taking this parameter only. The concept of elderly bipolar disorder has long been considered as an illness, as I have already told you. The first presentation with mania in elderly can be very challenging to accurately diagnose, classify and manage. And the international classification, the task force on older age bipolar disorder recommended that older age bipolar disorder includes patients of 50 years or more. Onset at the late age, and we always tell our students that look for organicity, look for the organic cause. Geriatric bipolar disorder includes both aging patients whose mood disorder presented earlier in the life and patient whose mood disorder presented for the first time in later life. There is another lacunes. Much of what is known about bipolar disorder in older people derived from clinical observations, and only a few studies present data from standardized neuropsychological and psychiatric measures. And the case classification of geriatric bipolar disorder can be extremely challenging as well. The presence of comorbid medical and neurological conditions in geriatric patients may potentially result in true bipolar disorder cases being classified in the category of bipolar disorder not otherwise classified, or mood disorders due to general medical condition if general medical condition or substance use as contributing factors cannot be entirely ruled out.
There is also one very interesting, yet little bit confusing to me, neurocognitive disorders unspecified. They have classified mild, they have classified the mild cognitive dysfunction, but then as a waste paper basket category, and otherwise unspecified is still retained here. Whereas DSM-5 is much more specific in terms of here, there is a mild, moderate and severe differentiation also. So the similarities between ICD-11 and DSM-5, to summarize, I think both systems to start with take an a nosological approach to start with, but we both try to lose the classification of psychopathology much more, which take the center stage. There has been a dimensional symptom assessment, and I think there is a need to harmonize as the time progresses between both ICD-11 and DSM-5. The research is already on. At least 3 papers came in the last year itself regarding some of this on the dementia category. One of the differences between them is the functional impairment mandatory for diagnosis and DSM-5. That is not there for ICD level. They need to be a functional impairment as a measure. And DSM-5 has a strict diagnostic criteria for each of the dementias. So that is probably not there again in ICD. ICD-11 has diagnostic guidelines, but not so strict a diagnostic criteria. So that would be a third differential between ICD and DSM-5 when we are discussing about the dementias. But the drawbacks persist. Neither ICD-11 nor DSM-5 have introduced at any of these criteria any neurobiological or genetic factors. It can be well argued that we have not reached this stage, but the current available evidence of the last 3 decades probably should have been at least incorporated. In that way, probably DSM-5 is much better in relation to ICD-11.
One comment is regarding the all this classification. We are not very sure about neurobiology, genetics. So this may be the, I mean, etiophysiologically, we are not very sure all these classes of dementia. That may be one factor still, the classification is.
I agree, sir. That's what I presented. See, the last comment was that the neurobiological basis of the disorders, though DSM-5 is much more stricter in terms of looking, but these two, the underlying, either there is some genetic evidences for some of the dementias. There is some evidence of biomarkers in the dementia which is emerging. Neither of the classifications have used that for the years. So that's what you ask. I agree with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we have started mentioning about the biomarkers in dementia. Now more details will be heard from Dr. Sandeep Grover on this topic. MER Chandigarh, recipient of the Young Psychiatrist Fellowship in the World Psychiatry Association at the 14th World Congress of Psychiatry Prague 2008, and was given honorary mention for the WPA Ulysses Vienna Prize for Young Psychiatrist 1, 2008, Tilak Venkogarao Award, Corporation Award 2010, Associate Editor of Indian Journal of Psychiatry 2009 to 2012. Saturday is yours.
Thank you, sir. In terms of emerging neurobiological evidence is what I will just try to discuss with you. I am not recommending that this has to be followed. At present, when we look at how we diagnose dementia, mostly now we diagnose dementia when patient has a clinically established syndrome. Until unless the syndrome is not fulfilled, we don't diagnose somebody as having dementia. So, but what we understand from the studies over the years that the process of dementia starts much, much earlier than actually when you see the clinical syndrome of dementia. The process is a slow growing process, and there are clinical, so-called pre-clinical signs and symptoms. Then we have a phase of so-called MCI, that we see a patient developing dementia again, which will be mild, moderate, moderate to severe or severe. So what is most important to understand that dementia is not a one-step illness which starts on the day one. It has a prolonged duration before which we can suspect and diagnose dementia, or at least we can make effort to change the course of the progressive neurodegeneration.
Admission rate in our hospital, and there will be improved medication adherence if we give proper psychoeducation. Psychotherapies for old age bipolar disorders exist. So second important thing is helping older people experience success. It's called HOPES. It's an integrated model of psychosocial rehabilitation and healthcare management for older adults with severe mental illness. This would definitely improve their social skills, community functions, and leisure creation. What they do in this is that they take classes of the elderly population every week. Then once they take 3 or 4 classes, they go for practice sessions. For example, they teach them how to fill up the withdrawal form of bank. Then they teach them, then they give them a practice that will accompany you to the bank and you just do it. So that is how they are reintegrated, or in our the clinical practice guidelines, which was last year released for bipolar affective disorders by IDS. In that also, we have a psychotherapeutic intervention mentioned in which CBT is there. and there are other psychotherapeutic interventions that were mentioned. Then specific pharmacotherapies, research again on pharmacotherapy is lagging because older adults are excluded from randomized controlled trials because of increased risk of medical complications. They are not normally included in our randomized controlled trials because of complications, because of ethical issues. Ethical committees don't normally give us permission for doing any RCTs. So most of the guidelines recommend that first line treatment of old age bipolar disorder should be same as young bipolar patients with specific attention. However, there is a question mark, there are certain cautions to be, cautious notes to be put down, that comorbid medical conditions have to be kept in mind, cognitive functioning has to be assessed, there is increased vulnerability to side effects, altered metabolism due to kidney and liver functions.
So MRI can be to some extent used as a initial. So in that case, we have to wait for some years more for some more non-invasive and affordable investigations to be made as a biomarker.
Yeah.
So it is a wonderful presentation and a very good thing.
Thank you, sir. All this. Today we are at a so-called crossroads. BSM, ICD have not accepted any of these findings. But people across the world, and neurologists, and they have got their so-called radiology friends, made them very sensitive to how to report a PET study or an MRI for them to use it clinically. That's something which we need to understand. Today we talk about so much about things, but normally how many of you end up sending and getting an MRI or CT, getting normal study as a report? Maybe about, I think 70% comes as a normal study. That's the basic problem which we are facing. So we need to also work that when we talk about integration as the theme of the conference, need to integrate, we need an integration between the radiologist, psychiatrist and the lab. Until we don't do that, possibly we will not reach to this dream which we are thinking that we will be able to.
Recently, a very interesting topic, newer developments in the pharmacological management of dementia, and the paper will be presented to us by Dr. P.T. Sid Kumar, Additional Professor, Department of Psychiatry in AIIMS, Life Fellow Indian Psychiatric Society and also Indian Association of Geriatric Mental Health, and Alzheimer's and Related Disorders Society of India, RC, Bangalore Chapter. Areas of interest are geriatric psychiatry, yoga intervention in elderly, metabolic abnormalities and psychiatric disorders.
It would be good to have a lot of biomarkers, and I'm sure there are, as Sandeep has described, a lot of developments in the last few decades, and many of these things what Sandeep talked about is routinely used in clinical practice, at least in the developed countries and the Western kind of settings, and some of which are available in our settings where we use it in the clinical practice. But if we ask whether these things have made a difference to the clinical practice, and it is still a kind of a difficult thing to answer very confidently or positively, because we earlier had these tools to diagnose by autopsy. We knew that people had amyloid plaques even when Alzheimer's diagnosed this condition, and there are many autopsy studies which were there. What we do now is we can diagnose through and a person is living and having symptoms. But the major limitation is that one third of people whom we clinically diagnose as dementia do not have these biomarkers, and somebody who has these biomarkers even at the death don't develop dementia. Predicting and reliably recruiting patients for drug trials, that is where the main issue is. Some differential diagnosis can be helped, but even if I have an accurate diagnosis which I can make 10 years before the person developed dementia, would I be happy now? And that is a question which you would like to answer now. Do we have a way to help them? Do we have an easy treatment? It is a big difficulty, I thought it, because of the financial impact, which is related not about the medical care, it is about because of the social care. The burden is primarily because of the social care, because the treatment is not effective and the medications are not really making a major difference. A new case is happening every 3 seconds, that is what is estimated. And the prevalence is around 50 million cases as of now globally, which is going to increase to 130 million in the next few decades. And which is predominantly going to increase from India and China, because in some developed countries, the estimated prevalence is at least reducing because their vascular risk factors are controlled to some extent, education is improved. We are going to see the burden of dementia much more in the next 20 years or 30 years. And it is one of the leading causes of death without an effective treatment. And that is a major issue, and many times in our settings, dementia is not recognized as a cause of death. But in Western countries, developed countries where dementia is documented clearly, it is one of the leading causes, and many times a person dies because of complications related to dementia. Now, when I talk about treatment, how do we conceptualize it?
The causes, the comorbidities or the physical causes associated with them, like B12 deficiency, folic acid deficiency and all these things. So they are also prevalent in depression as well. When old age depression, dementia, all these causes we have to rule out. Similarly,
can we cluster it with bipolar disorder in general? Because you know, particular system has increased. They have included vascular mania, late onset mania.
Yeah.
Vascular depressions, they have not included.
Yes.
We got
some
but
yes. But sir, it is coming up.
Huh?
I mean, it is coming up. That is, vascular depression is also coming up, because as the age is advancing, so we are seeing, I mean, these variants. That is, an old age depression, it could be vascular origin.
Now, up to bipolar type 6 has come. Maybe in future, bipolar type 7 will come, including all the stages.
Tomorrow, there will be a session on vascular depression. That a Bhaskar will speak on it.
So, is
there
any questions?
Sir, one last question.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Myself, Dr. Dhananjay. My question is like there are studies in which patients have been seen, like bipolar parents. One bipolar parent increase would be chance of 10 to 15%, and two bipolar parents increases to 30 to 40%. Is there any studies or your clinical experience in that?
Or elderly?
If you have found somebody with late onset bipolar, their siblings or any?
So there are not as such established studies. What Dr. Sandeep Grover group has shown that there are more family history. They have found it more as compared to Western literature. That is, elderly bipolar, there are family history is positive. There are Western literature they don't buy that. They say that as compared to early onset, late onset, less family. That is it. But not as you are saying that if one sibling is affected, if both are affected, or one parent or both of them are affected. So such kind of studies are not there in elderly. But there is a probability because if the bipolar illness starts at the age of, in earlier age,
and there is a recurrence in the later life. So in those group of patients, you may get this.
So that is a different ballgame altogether, yeah. Which means the early onset is repeating in late onset, going into graduating into late onset. And vis-a-vis the late onset, which means after 50 or 60 years, the first episode. First episode.
Thank you.
Thank you.
based on biomarkers, we might get some positive outputs, outcomes. And focus of intervention has shifted to early intervention, more from mild cognitive impairment to even asymptomatic stage of preclinical AD. Another possible reason is the complexity of AD pathophysiology and having multiple pathologies. Possibly we need to try combinations, no longer individual chemicals may be enough. We need to try combinations similar to other complex medical disorders. And shifting of clinical trials to early intervention, it necessitates further refinement of methodology. It brings in a lot of ethical issues, but we need to have better and sensitive outcome measures. So these are some of the challenges which people are working. There are some developments, and renewed focus on understanding the basic biology is again important, because we might have to look at other targets. And significant funding efforts from government and organizations, other organizations, carrier organizations like Alzheimer's Association, or some philanthropic funding, including Bill Gates, has started funding this initiative. And this is, these are some of the positive things. And but to conclude, I would say, still we need to focus on symptomatic treatment, because the large number of patients, particularly in our context, we will still be handling while people come to us with moderate severe stages. We are not getting enough people in preclinical stages or even MCA stages. So unfortunately, most of these disease modifying drugs will not be effective in them. We need to see as to how we have to improve their care and prepare facilities for carrying them. And another positive aspect which I have not covered much is about prevention. And that is something which is emerging as a big topic, multi-domain intervention and prevention. Because when we don't have effective cure, prevention is the way to go. And there are evidences from other studies where the incidence of dementia and expected projections have declined in some of the developed countries. In some of the well-conducted studies they have seen, possibly because of lifestyle modification, improvement in education, control of vascular risk factors. And that is something which we have to probably pursue. Thank you very much for the patient attention.
Thank you very much. Sorry that we will not have any question answer session because general body meeting is going. Thank you very much.
I finish it.
Comprehensive.
May I request Dr. Sandeep Kovar sir to kindly receive a token of appreciation from the chairpersons. May I now request Dr. G. Prasad Rao sir to kindly appreciate the token of appreciation. Thank you, respected chairpersons. Thank you, sir. That brings us to the end of